All truth passes through three stages. First, it is ridiculed. Second, it is violently opposed. Third, it is accepted as self-evident. Arthur Schopenhauer. Arthur Schopenhauer was a German philosopher of German origin, born February 22nd, 1788, and he died 1860 on the 21st of September. This time, I'd like to make a video about the so-called Nazi esoteric survival myth, or Imperial German survival myth, or so-called space Nazis from Iron Sky. I will present the evidence that I found online and try to make my case. I personally know many people that actually believe that there is this third power or Imperial German force out there that connected the dots from the UFO phenomenon to the Absatzbewegung during the Second World War and after the Second World War, the relocation of hundreds of thousands of people or troops and women to South America, South Pole and the Inner Earth. I will now try to prove systematically, or no, I will present the evidence like in a court of law and then make an assessment on it, because I get reactions from many people who watch my videos. Some even laugh and say they start laughing because they can't accept what I'm saying. But I only present with this testimony, photographic evidence, video footage, even infrared footage, witness testimony. I present this all in my videos, and people are still unable to accept this as a possibility because it goes way beyond their own mind. People cannot analyze the evidence and come to a conclusion. Their minds are not free. First, now a video of detailing this Imperial German survival myth. A short introduction from Chapter 7, Disposition of German Sausage Technologies After the War, from Henry Stevens. It portrays a view on history that many, many esoteric writers in Germany have. There are hundreds of books on the subjects. Many of them are banned and not allowed to be sold in Germany.
Henry Stevens, Hitler's Flying Saucers. A Guide to German Flying Discs of the Second World War. Chapter 7. Disposition of German saucer technology after the war. These are images, apparently, of German real discs. It is known that the Germans made contingency plans for the war's loss. On August 10, 1944, 9 months before the war in Europe ended, a meeting was called at the Hotel Rotes Haus in Strasbourg. In attendance were representatives of all the major industrial concerns, including IG Farben, Thyssen, Siemens, Krupp, Daimler-Benz, Rheinmetall-Borsig, as well as representatives of the major banks. Meeting with them were members of the SS. They were planning measures which will ensure the survival of the coming German defeat. See Part 4. Scientists, scientific plans, strategic materials and money were to be taken from Germany and secured in secret places, secret hiding places. Long-range cargo aircraft were to fly from Germany to Spain carrying the goods. From here, items were to be loaded onto U-boats bound to South America. It is possible that other destinations were also planned, such as Japan and the Antarctic base, originally established in 1938-1939 by the Richard Antarctic Expedition. The Antarctic base was first attacked by forces of many nations led by the United States in a 1946 military action codenamed Operation High Jump. This operation involved a fleet of ships, including an aircraft carrier, submarines, and support craft. It also involves aircraft and 4,000 armed troops under the command of Admiral Richard Evelyn Byrd. Immediately, four aircraft were mysteriously lost, and the whole operation, scheduled for 6 months' duration, was cancelled after less than 6 weeks of operation. The Antarctic base, Landingsport 211, was in operation until the late 1950s when it became the subject of an American nuclear test. In this test, three bombs were detonated under the cover of the International Geophysical Year of 1957-1954, see part 14. Landish claims the type of rockets in the test to attack point 211 were prototypes of the American Polaris missile, a solid fuel rocket which was later used operationally, the final design being fired for submarines underwater. Detonation of these atomic weapons over the base generated electromagnetic shock waves in which it was hoped would destroy the apparatus in the base used for defensive purposes. Landish claims his tactic failed. The electromagnetic pulse attack was insufficient to destroy the improved apparatus. Both high jump and this 1957-1958 attack turned out not only to be a fiasco, but to be superfluous. The greater part of the German forces had already abandoned Antarctic base in favor of a base in the South American Andes. National Examiner, January 26, 1988. America's fastest growing weekly. UFO mystery solved. Their leftover Nazis bent on establishing a bloody Fourth Reich. The solution to the UFO mystery has been found at long last. The aliens are actually Nazis bent on establishing a bloody Fourth Reich, and world governments have known about it all along, but they're scared to death, says a leading researcher. Nazi Germany has built a small fleet of UFOs as early as 1940, according to Christoph Friedrich, author of UFOs, Nazi Secret Weapon, Samizdat, Toronto, Canada. Friedrich claims that German UFO scientists escaped from their war-torn homelands as the Allied armies were closing in. Writes Friedrich, that some key scientists were obviously missing became clear, and sought some plants and their installations were located, the staff of their machinery and prototypes have disappeared, even test pilots have vanished. And Friedrich contends Hitler and his wife Eva Braun tricked the world into believing they committed suicide in a Berlin bunker during the last days of World War II. Among the evidence Friedrich presents that Hitler is alive, the bodies of Hitler and Braun were never produced. The items introduced as evidence are only circumstantial: two of Hitler's hats, one pair of panties with the initials EB, and a few bones. The blood stains found on the furniture in Hitler's quarters in the bunker were not of his blood type. The most important witnesses and the men closest to Hitler have never been found. There are too many reports and sightings, eyewitness reports, and even evidence that the suicide attempt was a brilliantly successful, carefully staged scenario. The researcher says Hitler and Braun were flown to Norway in one of the world's first jets. The pair then boarded a submarine and were delivered to a secret base in South America. Friedrich claims Hitler's U-boat convoy engaged in a fierce battle with the British Navy, and the Germans destroyed a British blockade with secret high-tech weaponry, wrote Friedrich. It would seem that the secret weapons, which Goebbels had spoken of such in glowing terms only a few days previous, were now put to use for the first time in an actual battle situation. The result was one sole survivor from a British destroyer, and it was from this, the captain, the words were uttered, "May God help me, may I never encounter such a force." The report of the captain was carried in El Mercurio, a Santiago Chilean newspaper. Friedrich contends that Hitler's secret agents used counterfeit US dollars and British pounds to finance the construction of secret military bases in South America and UFO bases in Antarctica. Hitler had planned far ahead and at long range, according to Friedrich. Obviously guided by the possible occupation and subsequent loss of Germany itself, he had cast around for land still available for colonization and found that Antarctica was at that time the only continent still unclaimed. Added Friedrich, the secret Nazi expeditionary force was headed by Captain Richter and took place in 1937-1938. The force landed in the area of Queen Maud Land and established bases there. Over 11,000 photographs were taken for mapping purposes. Incredibly, the researcher says the US and Soviet governments have known about the secret Nazi UFO bases for more than 40 years, but have covered up the truth because they do not know how to deal with it. Friedrich claims Nazi spacecrafts have become sophisticated thanks to extraterrestrials who befriended the Nazis while they were hiding in Antarctica. Writes the researcher, did Hitler's scientists perform their miracle alone, unaided, or did flying saucer people, perhaps visitors from other galaxies, given them a helping hand because they had mastered the new technology and consequently spoke the same or at least a similar technological language. Friedrich believes Hitler's so-called last battalion was springing to action with a worldwide economic collapse. Then the saucer Nazis will invade strategic military areas and rule the world. George Glidden.
This was the introduction. For the people that have not been viewing my videos, know now what I'm talking about. I made several videos on the topic already, analyzing documents that have been leaked online, even more the so-called Hollow Earth. And just check out my videos for a detailed analysis of this. This is more on the existence of the UFO Imperial German phenomenon. And the following will now check at documents that were found in bunkers in Germany from the SS secret archives. These are also online for everybody to download and view, and you can look at them and you see saucer or disc type aircraft or saucer type aircraft depicted on these documents. And the description is really detailed, detailing practically the propulsion systems and how that works, and even on the Magnetfeldinsteuerung, well, the magnetic felt inducing driving or maneuvering thrusters or maneuvering capability of this saucer type aircraft. And it's really detailed. Even the armaments are depicted. We will check out now the documents.
This is Deutsch.
Well, that is from the SS secret archives. It depicts a circular type aircraft of this aircraft called the Haunebu 1. And here you see the SS emblem and the Geheime Kommandosache. Meaning secret command document, actually, Geheime Kommandosache. And here you can see how many numbers are available. Flugkreiselerprobung Stand 1, meaning disc aircraft trial or test. From the Haunebu 1, they have 2 pieces. From the Haunebu 2, they have 7 pieces. And from the Haunebu 3, they only have 1 piece. The Vril 1 Jäger or the Vril 1 fighter, 17 pieces were available. Here it is the SSE-4, the department SSE-4, that actually engineered these incredible exotic technologies. And here is also mentioned the Schumann levitator, practically the technology or the engine that drives these crafts. Here are the details of the disc aircraft Haunebu 1, or disc spacecraft. Mittelschwerer bewaffneter Flugkreisel Typ Haunebu 1, meaning moderately armed disc aircraft type Haunebu 1. Here we have the Durchmesser or diameters at 25 meters. The propulsion system or Antriebs is the Thule-Tachionators. And the control or steering controls is done with a magnetic Felsenpulsor. The velocity is at 4,800 km per hour, or arithmetically until 17,000, well, theoretically probably. The range is in air and traveling time 18 hours. The armaments or bewaffnung is 2x8cm KSK in rotating towers or turrets. KSK meaning Kraftstrahlkanone. The energy beam weapons developed by the Imperial Germans also back then. And 4x Mark 108 100 machine guns probably, I'm not really sure. The Außenpanzerung or external armor is double Vigdalen, a special alloy also developed back then. The Haunebu 1 has a crew, Besatzung, of 8 men. The space traveling capacity is at 60%. The hovering capacity, Stillschwebefähigkeit, 8 minutes. Well, the traveling capacity, it's day and night, probably all weather capacity. That is one of the documents from the Hannibal One that it can be downloaded online. You just have to Google them. And they're in German. Now we'll look at the following document. Well, this is the schematics of the Hannibal 2, and it even gives us the source of these documents. It's an alleged photocopy of SS plans for Hannibal 2 being designed in 1943 from the German book Die dunkle Seite des Mondes, The Dark Side of the Moon by Brad Harris, 1996 from Pandora Books, Germany. Now we will look at the details of this image or photocopy or schematics. And we can see a date, 7th of November 1943, SS Entwicklungsstelle 4, or SS Department E4, this SS Development Department E4. And there you see the schematics of a disc aircraft, Hannibal 2. And here it says, Mitte schwerer bewaffneter Flugkreisel, Tippe Hannibal 2. Medium heavy armed circular aircraft type Hannibal 2. The diameter or Durchmesser is 26.3 meters. The propulsion system or Antrieb is not a Thule Tachyonator. The steering controls, it's a magnetic felt impulsor. This velocity is at 6,000 kilometers per hour or arithmetically at until 21,000 kilometers per hour possible. The range or Reichweite in flight hours or in flight time is 55 hours, and the armament is 6 times KSK in 3 turrets. The external armor again is 3 times Sigtalen, and the crew is a 9 man. Transport capacity up to 20 people, can transport up to 20 people. And the spacefaring capability is at 100%. And here we have a message. Vom Führer verlangt er 100%ig Einsatzreife. Rundum kann allerdings nicht vor Ende des nächsten Jahres erwartet werden. Erst ab Serie 9. Well, what it actually says here is that the Führer demands practically that it's totally that it's totally capable of already being used. And they say it's not possible before the end of the next year. Or no, before the end of the year. And it's 1943, the 7th of November, 1943, according to this document. So the Führer actually demanded that these actually wonder weapons should be 100% immediately applicable. So they were practically still in development back then. Well, in the following document, we will see an Andromeda device or an Andromeda Gerät. Again, the source of this apparent document is Die dunkle Seite des Mondes, The Dark Side of the Moon by Brad Harris, 1996 Pandora Books of Germany. Now, these are the schematics of another spacecraft. It's called the Andromeda Gerät, or the Andromeda device, or Andromeda spacecraft. As you can see here, it is practically a carrier craft, designed practically to carry a Hannibal 2 Gerät in its internal place. It's depicted as H2 Gerät, Hannibal 2. Here are the so-called energy towers, or KSK Drehtürme, 3 times 7 centimeters KSK. Turrets built within the spacecraft. Here are 2x11 KSK, and even other types of weapons that are practically depicted here. Here are smaller, bays, the so-called 2x Vril 1 or Vril 2 fighters, also anti-gravitic spacecraft or aircraft, and it's very detailed. It's practically a carrier spacecraft. Well, these are apparent pictures released by the Orion Conspiracy documentary, and it depicts in really detailed this type of crafts. They are practically longer, apparently. The original was 139 meters from the document. Here's another picture released from also the Orion conspiracy documentary video that you can view online, and it also depicts this round type cigar-shaped UFO or spacecraft or Andromeda-Gerät or Andromeda device. This is practically the SS documents also found in a bunker in Germany, and it gives us the details, the schematics of an Andromeda-Gerät or an Andromeda device. And also, again, like the other document, in really high detail, how much what it is actually is. I had a high-resolution version of this a long time ago, but I couldn't find it. But nevertheless, I'll read it. Bewaffneter Träger und Langstreckenraumschiff Andromeda-Gerät. Meaning armed carrier and long-distance spaceship Andromeda device. The length is 139 meters, the diameter or the Durchmesser 30 meters. The propulsion system is again 4 times Thule Tachyonatoren and 4 times Schumann levitators. The steering controls or Steuerung, magnetic felt impulsors, Geschwindigkeit or speed or velocity, keine Angaben or not specified. Or rechnerisch, meaning again, arithmetically, theoretically to 300,000 kilometers per second, possible. Range or Reichweite, again, not specified. Theoretically unlimited, that's what it said here. Armaments or Bewaffnung, 2 times turrets, Drehtürme, 2 times 2 KSI or KSK, Kraftstrahlkanone. Two turrets, and 4 R-100 probably missiles or whatever. The external armor or armor is unknown. Keine Angaben, unbekannt. Possibly 3 times Sigtalen. Besatzung or the crew of the spacecraft or Andromeda device is 130 men. The space traveling capacity of this craft is 100%. Well, this is the schematics of the Hannibal 3. I will not go through it in detail, but it's a schwere bewaffneter Flugkreisel Hannibal 3. It is a heavy armed disc aircraft Hannibal 3. The diameter, Durchmesser, 71 meters in diameters. And what's interesting here, of course, is the crew is 32 men. The capacity to transport people is maximum of 70 people that they can transport. And spacefaring capability or space traveling capability is 100%. It also has an armament, 4 times 11 KSK cannons, and 1 or 3 times 3 times rotary turrets below. These are 3 rotary turrets, and this is the Hannibal 3. This is another schematics of apparently Hannibal 4 of 120 meters in diameter, designed as an interstellar ship. We analyzed now 5 different documents depicting 5 different crafts: the Hannibal 1, the Hannibal 2, the Hannibal 3, and even a small depiction of the Hannibal 4, although it looks reconstructed, and the Andromeda spacecraft. These documents are really detailed and practically give all the properties of these ships in a military-type manner. Well, all the different properties of the ships, depiction of what they can do, range, operational range, speed, diameters, lengths, measurements, capacity to transport, and so on, and even space traveling capabilities. For one of the images or documents, we found the source, but the source is Die dunkle Seite des Mondes, The Dark Side of the Moon, by Brad Harris, 1996, Pandora Books, Germany. I tried looking for this book, but couldn't download it. Now we will look at practically evidence of today, of the modern UFO phenomenon, and compare it to the known crafts that we have checked out in these ancient documents.
The Royal Society started experimenting with alternative energies and technologies in the 1920s. During the 29 years that they developed these aircrafts, they built several types of real levitation devices. The Royal SS Military Technical Branch E4. They built the Royal 1, 17 pieces by 1941, the Royal 2, the Royal 3, the Royal 4, and so on. The Royal 8, or Odin, was destined to go to the planet Aldebaran in the star system Taurus in 1945, in March of 1945. As you can see, they have built many types of different crafts.
Astonishing cigar-shaped UFO stabilized and zoomed.
UFOs shaped like cigars spotted by International Space Station. Two cigar-shaped UFOs were spotted near the International Space Station on their last beam of the solar system. From theexaminer.com. Huge cylindrical UFO captured by Mars Curiosity rover. May 1st, 2014. The latest images released by Mars Curiosity rover show that appeared to be a very large cylindrical UFO traveling the Martian night sky. Shaped UFO spotted. Burnham on the Sea, UK.
There it is. Let's zoom in on it. Hard to pick out though. I'll zoom in. No, it's weird. Let's just zoom back.
And I saw something there, Vernon.
Keep recording.
Yeah, it's black now. Ooh. It's star, that's for sure, guaranteed. Oh, this, yeah.
If you Google images cigar-shaped UFOs, you get the following hits. The long Andromeda type, Andromeda cigar, or the cigar shaped of this UFO with a gleaming metal shine. Comparable to this picture, the same metal color. This is another image of gravefalcon.us, and it portrays practically a cigar-shaped UFO in the image. Photos from the Project Blue Book files of cylindrical UFO that hovered over New York City on March 20, 1950. The military suggested that it was possibly the moon. The photographer's name was deleted from the project's files, as were most of the names when the material was finally declassified and released. These are some of the best photographs of a cylindrical UFO thought to be a mothership that would launch flying saucers. This is another image of the Andromeda-Gerät, given out by Jan Udo Hauly or Jan van Helsing in his book Unternehmen Aldebaran. And these images have been tested on authenticity.
So what did you see, Jordan?
It was a cigar shape. But I've seen it before. I've seen this exact same thing twice before. Once in Burbank about a year and a half to 2 years ago with Paul Hunt of Atlantis Books. We were standing out in the parking lot one afternoon, late afternoon, and Paul and I were standing in the parking lot, and overhead, it looked to be about maybe two or three blocks away, was this long cigar shape. Thing just floating there for a few minutes. And the more we started staring at it, the more it became obvious that this was a UFO, because it wasn't moving, it was just sitting there. And then it just went, it's gone. This one was identical, but now we're seeing it in the daylight. That was in, the first time I saw it was in the evening, early evening. I've seen it, like I said, twice before, and this is the third time I've seen it, but it's still there. But he's really moved out now. Now it's turning around. You can see it turning. We saw it when it was close. When it was very, very close. And the moment I got out of the car, I saw it, and I said to Wendy, I said, well, there's the UFO Paul Hunt and I have seen before.
Well, that is an image made by George Adamski in 13th of September 1952, and he claimed to be in contact with people from Venus. But as you can see, it is saucer-type, bell-shaped, comparable to the schematics that we found online. That is another picture made by George Adamski back then in 1952, and they are bell-shaped, as depicted in this picture of a Hanobu 2 device. It's bell-shaped with three turrets below. This one is bell-shaped and also has two or three turrets. If you Google White House UFOs, you get the following hits. In July of 1952, an entire formation of UFOs flew over the White House. It was even in the news back then. In July of 1952, an entire formation up to 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12 over 14 spacecraft or Imperial German disc aircraft flew over the White House. Again, photographic evidence that these craft exist. YouTube, the Malmstrom UFO incident. In 1967, a fleet of UFOs or Imperial German Hanobu or disc aircraft paralyzed or put off power the ICBMs at Malmstrom Air Force Base, the missile base at Malmstrom. And if you Google even more, UFO shoots down ICBM, you get a witness testimony of somebody who worked there and saw practically via camera that a UFO shot down an ICBM. UFO researcher claims Air Force not revealing truth about the so-called UFOs, about the UFOs. In March of 1967, an entire missile facility was put off power by UFOs.
And flying downrange, we got all three stages of powered flight, and as the dummy warhead and the package flew on down range, we were all celebrating the fact that we had seen the thing and accomplished the mission. When I got back to the base with the film the next day, I was called into the office of Major Florence J. Mansman, and there were three people in gray suits standing in there. There was a 16mm camera and a screen set up. Major Mansman said, "Lieutenant, sit down and watch this." And he turned down the lights, turned on the camera, on the projector, and the film came on. And I recognized it as the film that we'd shot at Big Sur the previous day. Toward the end of the flight, I was looking at Major Mansman saying, "Pretty good stuff, huh, sir?" And suddenly he said, "Just watch this." And as I watched, the warhead, the dummy warhead, the chaff that was put out in front of it as a decoy to deflect the Russian anti-missile tracking radar. Everything was flying along, and suddenly, in the same direction this stuff was flying at about 8,000 miles an hour, an object came into the frame, shot a beam of light at the warhead, flew up to the top, shot another beam of light at the warhead, flew around the direction it was flying, shot another beam of light at the warhead, flew down, shot another beam of light at the warhead, and flew out the same way it came in.
Well, I don't see it. Why didn't you see this when you were shooting it?
Well, it was 600 to 800 miles away from us.
Oh, I got you. They confiscated.
Well, first of all, the Major Mansman said to me, "What was that? Were you guys screwing around up there?" I said, "No, sir." And he said, "Then tell me what that was." And I said, "We got a UFO." And he said, "Lieutenant, you are never to speak of this again. As far as you're concerned, this didn't happen.
Hold on, guys. I'll be right back. I got to take a break. Okay, that's weird. You think there's a national defense plan for aliens? Sounds crazy. We'll ask about that next.
This is Deutsch.
If you YouTube Night Vision UFO, you get the following footage. I presented the evidence that is there, and I tried making a case that there is something more that you can view through your eyes. This Imperial German survival myth. I made several videos on the Hollow Earth theory, and possibly on New Germany or New Germania, the so-called colony of the Imperial Germans in the Inner Earth. Its capital city is named New Berlin, and it has apparently 1.5 million inhabitants. Now we'll leave you with a video from Randolph Winters, who also talks on this subject. Enjoy!
Okay, oh, I didn't know these were on here. These are some of the Miami pictures, some of the ones that I didn't put on the tape, because I'll kind of go through them here. Here's the kid in Miami. His name is Manny Escondon, is his real name. He's taking notes. Here these discs came in, his girlfriend took the pictures. These are flat bottom discs, they're made on Earth, they're called Vril disc, V-R-I-L. They're manufactured down in Brazil. They also have a factory in down by in New Schwabenland in Antarctica. Here's another picture. Here's a news copter came in. Look at the first three discs. When they see the copter, they start to turn invisible or put their shields up, and the first three crafts that go out in a series are just becoming invisible when he snapped the picture. It was taken with a Polaroid at a 30th of a second, so it caught it right mid of going out there. These discs were designed by German technology in the late 40s. The first ones we know of that were tested out were probably around 47 or 48. They're called Vril levitation devices. As you can see, they actually fly quite well. Notice the nice V formation. Being typical earthbound Air Force pilots, they're still flying in formation. We understand this technology a little bit because intelligence has shot down some of their ships, learned how they're doing it. And when you hear rumors about how the Americans are building flying discs, what we're doing is playing catch-up to the German technology that's been around since the 40s. Their technology has accelerated tremendously. They make two different types of levitation devices. That's what we're doing out in Area 51. We manufacture the devices in San Diego. They're put together by General Electric. We test them in Area 51. Here's the German disc parked down on the ground at a facility down in Brazil. Here's four guys standing next to it down there. There's a whole row of them. He couldn't count how many were down there. He had his Polaroid with him and grabbed a few short shots there. Over here's two guys here on a craft coming in. You can see the two guys standing here. And down here at the bottom, which I know isn't clear, is one of these old bell-shaped crafts. Many of you are probably not familiar, but there was a fellow named George Adamski back in 1962 who claimed to be having contacts with people from Venus. This was the craft he was taking pictures of. George's contacts were real, but he wasn't having contacts with anybody from Venus. The blonde-haired ladies that were inside the craft were actually from Brazil. That's where the crafts were flying out of. They've been making them down there since about 1947. They find it very convenient if they make contact or land somewhere to tell people they're extraterrestrials, and we're very open to it. If they tell them, hi, we're part of a German intelligence group from Brazil, people would freak out. I got my camcorder and I've got my micro lens on here getting as close as I can to this picture. It's a very, very small Polaroid picture that's about that big, and it got wet in the rain. He left it in the windowsill. So I've ironed it and put it on paper so we didn't lose it. And I'm copying it with my macro. Here's the whole picture. Over here is one of the old bell-shaped discs. There's one in the air. Notice the platforms they're sitting on. There's a guy standing here. There's a guy over here just coming out of this disc. I'm trying to get real close to the bottom of it here so we can see what they're like. This is an area, if you look on a map, I've got a little videotape over there if you're interested in learning more about this information, called Space Cities. I've narrowed it down to about within a 200-mile range where this facility is at and what they're doing down there. Here's the guy standing there. The discs sit down on the platforms. Remember earlier I was telling you about how the condensers charge out the bottom? They have to charge the field up. If you get too close to the Earth, the charge dissipates because it's grounded. These metal platforms, they sit them down on the platforms, then they can keep the ship charged up. And if they need to take back off right away, they can. They don't have to wait for the ship to charge back up. The platforms charge them up for them, so they can lift right back off. If they would set it down without the platform on the tripod legs, they got to go through the process again of charging the capacitors up, which takes 3 to 4 minutes. So if they're in a hurry to get away, they're in big trouble. These old bell-shaped discs actually have 3 Mercedes-Benz truck engines in them driving the magnetic field. This was their first design that they made. This was the first ones that the Germans built. These craft here were under consideration, and they were working on them in the end of World War II. When you hear about Hitler's secret weapon at the World War II, if you go back and look at the newspapers, that's what he was talking about. They were in hopes they would get these things up and working, and they would still have a chance then to win the war. Fortunately for all of us, they did not, or we'd all be speaking German today. Interesting side effect, too, once they finally did get them up and working, they made lousy war weapons because the field around them prevents you from dropping bombs or anything out of them. It ignites the bombs. So it took them a while. They don't even have weapons on them for a while, and then they had to come up with other kinds of devices. This was the first pictures I saw from the kid in Florida of his German contacts. And to my knowledge, I still think they're his best and perhaps his only contacts. I think he probably had a couple of contacts from these people. They came, they took him for a ride, it looks like on one or two occasions, and then perhaps they never came back. So we found this situation on several people around the planet. So it's not an uncommon situation.
That was Randolph Winters on Imperial German UFOs, depicting the alternative history of the Third Reich and the Germans, actually. Well, I presented in this video witness testimony, photographic evidence, video footage of Andromeda spacecraft and Imperial German steel zeppelins. All this evidence is there for you to see. And now it's up to you to see that this evidence is fabricated, for you to make believe that there is some Imperial German force out there, or that it is real evidence depicting another totally different reality. You have to break free from the dogmatic belief systems that they indoctrinated you with, in all aspects, even accepting the possibility that the Third Reich, or Germany back then, was already a spacefaring civilization. There's an entire USOs phenomenon in the global oceans. The military vessels of the United States Navy, and even the Russians, followed so-called unidentified submerged vehicles, or so-called ghost submarines. If you Google them, you will find an incredible amount of hits in this area. Apparently, these unidentified submerged vehicles go at incredible speeds underwater, and it has been speculated that they are from the Imperial Germans. It all goes back to that creation of the Third Reich, where there was the Absatzbewegung and the relocation of hundreds of thousands of troops to South America, to South Pole, and the inner Earth. and practically the relocation and rebuilding of bases globally. Now, this was just a video where I wanted to present the evidence and build up my case. Just imagine we were be in front of a judge or in front of a jury, and I present you with all this evidence that there is. How would the jury react? Or even the judge? The jury and the judge have to build up their knowledge on the case by assimilating evidence and viewing all evidence that is there, and then make up a conclusion on what really happened. And that is the same thing in history, even if this is as incredible as what I portrayed in this video. You have to build up your knowledge base, and by sound reasoning, logic and deduction, you have to keep the evidence that confirms certain facts or certain beliefs or not, and then discard the stuff that cannot be proven. Historical revisionism as an example. The same with this. You have to look at the evidence and build up your view on reality according to the evidence that you see, and not let your inner workings or inner programmings of Hollywood, be it now even over the so-called ET phenomenon, make you react in such a way that you say it's all bullshit because it's not possible. Our civilization is the most modern civilization that there is, and we cannot believe that the Imperial Germany or the Third Reich was a spacefaring civilization. We are not the most advanced civilization on this planet. There have been numerous civilizations before this one, and we were not the most advanced. I believe ancient Egypt was spiritually, and even in some degrees, more advanced than us, spiritually and in the psionic sciences. So you have to build up your view on reality according to the evidence that you have, and not let your pre-programmed reactions affect your reasoning and judgment on these subjects. That is why I have an open mind. I could be wrong, but I look at the evidence that is there and build up my view on reality. That is why for me, astral projection on OBEs is a reality. I induced it and read the books on the subject on how people can induce it themselves. I build up my view on reality according to my own experiences, logic, reasoning and deduction, and evidence that I find online or in the real world. That is how everybody has to do it. Now I present evidence here. I hope you enjoyed this video, and cheers.